So let's talk about stimulus for a moment. And when a stimulus occurs, that will cause a local change in the membrane of the neuron. And here we can see we've got a neuron, and there's a little stimulus event on a dendrite. So what happens is a local change in the electricity of the membrane occurs due to that stimulus, and that's what we call a graded potential. If the change is big enough to get us to threshold, then we'll get an action potential. We've already discussed action potentials. If the change isn't big enough to quite get to threshold, then that graded potential will basically just die out over time. Okay, little stimulus, not big enough to get to threshold, no action potential. However, there are some stimuli that instead of taking us towards threshold, which by the way, that's excitatory because it's getting close. Can you feel the excitement? Okay, it's getting close to threshold, so that's an excitatory postsynaptic potential. However, sometimes a stimulus will take the membrane farther away from threshold, and that's actually inhibitory because it's going to prevent or make it harder for the membrane to get to threshold. So that's what we call an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. It's a small event, a graded potential, that takes us away and takes us away from excitation and towards inhibition. So we have excitatory postsynaptic potentials and inhibitory postsynaptic potentials. And they're again just small events that occur on the membrane. And over time, the sodium potassium pump will reestablish the membrane potential. Again, these events are not taking us to threshold, therefore, neither one would cause an action potential. So here's another example of that event. Here we have an event right here on the dendrite. It's a graded potential. It will cause a change on the membrane, but it's not quite enough to get to threshold, so it dies out over time. And maybe we might have another small graded potential that occurs later, but it's going to die out over time. Again, the sodium potassium pump reestablishing the resting membrane potential. Well, what if we have a stimulus followed by another stimulus? Well, the first stimulus will depolarize the membrane, and if the second stimulus comes fast enough on the heels of the first one, it will depolarize the membrane far enough so that we actually do get to threshold, and bam, pow, there's the action potential. Okay, so that's what we call temporal summation. Those are the words. Temporal summation means pertaining to time, so we can actually add up these graded potentials if they come quickly enough after one another that the membrane will actually hit threshold, so we get an action potential. And that's not the only way these things can be added together. If we have an event occurring or events occurring simultaneously but on different areas, well, those areas can add up, and that's what we call spatial summation. So here we have different parts of the neuron being stimulated. Almost forgot the word there. Hello. And so that simultaneous stimulation can be added to where we hit threshold, and again, bam, there's the action potential. Well, remember that potentials, graded potentials, aren't always excitatory. Sometimes they can be inhibitory. So if we get spatial summation where one is excitatory and one is inhibitory, those are effectually going to cancel one another out. And after that occurs, again, we hit resting membrane potential with the sodium potassium pump. And that's how potentials occur and how they can affect the neuron, either generating an action potential or inhibiting an action potential, depending on whether they are excitatory or inhibitory.